I've never been good at goodbyes. I'm terrible at them. There is one goodbye I wish I could have made. I wish I could have said goodbye to Tupelo. This is Tupelo's grave right in here. She was the first bird that I was ever taking care of that died. I had an experience with her the night before, which makes me think that she was dying. She was a total cripple at that point. She was completely helpless. She couldn't do anything for herself. She couldn't even feed herself anymore. And so I got some formula. It's a powder that you mix with water, and then you put it in the syringe, and you feed them that way. At first, she always fought me. But after a while, she just, you know, it was dinner time. She liked it. And so we bonded. But it was a pretty gloomy existence for her. So I decided that I'd start taking her for little walks out in the garden. They love being in the sun. They like being warm. I had a heater that she used to sit by. So I'd take her around to different plants, and I'd hold her up to the flowers. And she used to look at them. It was like she really enjoyed doing it. She seemed to. Her favorite seemed to be this fuchsia that has some especially nice blossoms on it. I'd hold her up to those blossoms, and she'd stare at them intently. And she was really good-hearted.
That's a good bird.
So one night, I used to lay Tupelo right next to me while I was reading, and she'd just sort of snuggle up against me, and she really liked that. But the moment I picked her up, I felt this really strange vibe pass through me. It was like real gratitude that I had picked her up and put her in the bed. It really felt like it was coming from her. I thought, well, that's strange. That's unusual. I wonder what that is. After about 20 or 30 minutes, I wasn't going to let her stay in the bed with me, or I could crush her. So I closed the book, and I picked up Tupelo, and I put her on the floor. And the moment I did, I felt regret and resignation. Very strong, very clearly coming from her. The next morning, I started looking for Tupelo, and I couldn't find her anywhere. Birds, when they're sick, really like heat. I had this heater over here on the other side of the couch, and she had crawled over to it, and she was dead. I think that what she was doing, you know, like, I think she knew she was dying. She was getting cold, probably, but she knew she was fading or something, and she wanted to be with me. I wish I had been there with her as she died. I could have been holding her. How do you get so attached to an animal like that? I know there's lots of people, you know, that have experienced something like this, but in a certain sense, they're a lot purer than we are because we have a lot of neurotic thoughts, things that, you know, bind us up inside, and we play a lot of games that animals don't play. They're really straightforward. She depended on me, so she loved me. And I felt that. The thing that's interesting to me, actually, a lot of people think that this is anthropomorphism. But I felt those, you know, those two emotions pass through me. They came from her. I wasn't looking for anything. I was preoccupied. I was thinking about something else. So to say that animals don't have these kind of things is nonsense. And I think it's cruel nonsense. We do a lot of bad things to animals because we don't believe that, you know, they feel anything. So up until Tupelo's death, you know, people would often come up to me and say, boy, you're really into this, aren't you? You really love those birds. And I was always worried that people were going to think of me as eccentric for getting so deeply involved in this, and I'd always downplay it, like, oh, you know, no, It's not, it's just kind of a hobby, yeah. It's just a hobby. It's just something I'm sort of doing to pass the time. But because I couldn't talk to anybody for 3 days, after Tupelo's death, I said, okay, well, it's just unreal to talk to people that way. That's not true. I had to admit after that, that I really did love them. I was unconsciously anthropocentric. I only thought of it in terms of human beings. I would say, if somebody asked me, do animals have thoughts and feelings? I would say, oh, sure, of course. But I didn't put it into a whole. I only thought, when I was thinking about consciousness, I was only thinking in terms of human beings. There's a number of events that have made me think differently about this, but Tupelo's story is definitely one thing that contributed to that idea, and that idea being that all life is one whole. It really is. There's a story that Suzuki Roshi told. He was the Zen master at the Zen Center here in San Francisco. He went to Yosemite, and he sees this big waterfall coming over this cliff. And it's one river at the top of the cliff, but as it falls, the river breaks up into all these individual droplets. And then it hits the bottom of the cliff, and it's one river again. We're all one river until we hit this cliff. That distance between the top of the cliff and the bottom of the cliff is our life. And all the individual little droplets think they really are individual little droplets until they hit the bottom, and then they're gone. But, that droplet doesn't lose anything. It gains. It gains the rest of the river.